Hello, everyone. I'm Denise Malzerol, a professor in the Science, Technology, and Environmental Policy program, and I'm very pleased to welcome May Boeve, the executive director of 350.org, a global campaign to fight climate change, to the Woodrow Wilson School. And I'm really pleased to see all of you here today. 350.org got its name from what some scientists say is the maximum level of carbon dioxide possible in the atmosphere to maintain a climate similar to the one we know today, 350 parts per million carbon dioxide out of a million parts of air composed of other compounds. The work of this organization is particularly critical at this point in US history. In January, President Trump was inaugurated and has proceeded to appoint a cabinet and set of advisors who are more anti-environmentalist than any previous administration. His Environmental Protection Agency administrator, Scott Pruitt, is a clear climate denier, saying just today that he does not agree that carbon dioxide is a primary contributor to the global warming that we see. Pruitt will be involved in rolling back President Obama's two signature greenhouse gas mitigation policies, which were intended to improve fuel efficiency in vehicles and hence to reduce CO2 emissions, and to reduce emissions of CO2 and health-damaging air pollutants from power plants. In addition, the White House is considering a substantial cut in funding for climate science research. At this junction, 350.org's creative communications, organizing, and mass mobilizations are particularly critical in maintaining a sense of urgency in addressing climate change. 350.org's online campaigns, grassroots organizing, and mass public actions are led from the bottom up by individuals in 188 countries. The effort focuses on three main goals: keeping carbon in the ground, helping build a new, more equitable, low-carbon economy, and pressuring governments into limiting emissions. May is a true activist and has been profiled by Time magazine as a next-generation leader. She played a key organizational role in last year's historic People's Climate March, which brought 400,000 people to the streets of New York City demanding action on climate change. And I'm pleased to say that I think Princeton sent four buses to New York for that rally, and I was one of the people on one of those buses. She started 350.org along with six other undergraduates at Middlebury College, and if there's undergraduates here, I think you can see her as a real role model, as someone who can take action to really bring about change, even as an undergraduate. So she, with the six undergraduates at Middlebury and Bill McKibben, a Vermont environmentalist, started 350.org. It's now a widely recognized organization leading efforts to highlight both the impacts of climate change and the opportunities to create jobs and improve health while dramatically reducing our dependence on fossil fuels. Boeve is visiting the Woodrow Wilson School as part of its dean's, as part of the Dean's Innovation, Science, Technology, and Environmental Policy Initiative. Please join me in welcoming her.
Hi, everyone. How's everybody doing?
Good.
Good. Thank you so much for that introduction, which anticipated some things I wanted to ask you about, so that was very helpful. And it's really been an honor and a total pleasure to be here for the last day or so and getting to see now some familiar faces from conversations, and some very, very longtime friends in the audience as well. And I've always wanted to visit the Woodrow Wilson School, so I'm just very appreciative of this opportunity. So I want to talk about the climate movement, about the work of 350.org, and I also hope to shed some light on a relevant topic, this question of oppressive regimes, and look at it from a global lens. It's a very large topic. It's not limited to climate change by any means, but it's my hope that the climate fight can be a useful window into unpacking this larger topic and also hopefully provide some bigger avenues for solutions. I also want to pay special attention to the specific and unique threat posed by Donald Trump and how he has linked oil and state. And because while rising right-wing populism is a global phenomenon, we live here in this country, and the tools at Trump's disposal can wreak a massive and truly global impact. But first, a bit about me and about 350 and about why this topic was important to discuss with you today. And since I think it's often better to show than to tell, I want to start by sharing a video we made after the People's Climate March, which took place just a couple of years ago. And we will be hosting another one on April 29th in Washington. And before you said Princeton organized four buses, I was already going to challenge you to organize five buses. So I stand with that statement. Maybe six buses is probably more practical. But in all seriousness, that's an open invitation. I hope you all can come. So before I say anything else, I want to show this video, and then I'll say more about the topic.
The People's Climate March will take place 2 days before President Obama and world leaders attend a climate summit at the UN.
Climate change will bring more extreme weather, and action is now more urgent than ever.
Millions of people around the world gather in the largest climate action march in history.
The biggest gathering seeking to address climate change ever.
2,000 rallies in 162 countries from Paris, Melbourne, Australia, Rio de Janeiro.
Activists are filling the streets to demand action on climate change.
We are here because we are redefining this moment, this movement, this time. I want to thank all of the marchers today for coming together and taking a stand. We need you.
Also a massive people's march. I hope the leaders of the world listened.
We're the first generation to feel the impacts of climate change and the last to do anything about it.
Our citizens keep marching. We cannot pretend we do not hear them. We have to answer the call.
So, for those of you who are new to our work, this is what we try to do, organize mass mobilizations that help demonstrate that there's a mass movement engaged on this issue. But more about that later. So this all came out of a campus activist group, not unlike what is alive in Princeton. And I understand there was a massive action just this Monday.
You should probably close the other tab.
Ooh, thank you. More videos will start playing. Ominous videos with that music. And so that's why I love being on a campus and getting to meet so many students who are so engaged, because that's exactly what I was part of, which has shaped my entire life. And so we were a group of friends active at Middlebury College getting really interested and concerned about climate change and coming to talks like this and feeling like this was something that was a truly global phenomenon, but we could actually impact at Middlebury. So we would organize poetry readings about climate change, and we got every dorm to change their light bulbs. And eventually we got Middlebury to change its electricity policy, which actually just was fully completed a couple of months ago. And so we thought we might be able to make this our life's work. And frankly, due to a lot of the resources, privilege you have going to a school like Middlebury or Princeton, that's what we were able to do. And we did have a good idea as well, but both of those things came into play in making that possible. And what we set out to do was organize a global day of action, kind of like what you saw in the video. And that was in 2009. We didn't think we'd start an organization. Really did not predict that this is the kind of thing that I would be doing today. But the action was a success and surprised us in many ways. And I wonder if there are people in the audience who were part of that first action in 2009. Okay, wonderful. And so there were over 5,200 events in 182 countries. And we wanted to do this because we knew people cared about climate change, but it was very hard to see that. There was a lot of research, there was a lot of advocacy work, but the sense that this was a social movement was really hard to detect. You certainly weren't reading about it in the paper, and politicians didn't talk about climate change as an issue of global concern, the way they talked about poverty or education or healthcare, but climate didn't register, and yet it was this massive scientific emergency. So where was the disconnect? And we wanted to try to demonstrate that through actions. But unlike what I'd studied in my classes, the protest didn't lead to policy change. And at that time, the policy forum was in Copenhagen in 2009 at the UN. And being somewhat naive, as I was, can be a useful thing because you try things that you wouldn't think to try if you knew more. But I certainly hoped that this massive set of actions and the science and the overwhelming evidence would lead to a global agreement, and we didn't get it. But in this case, that came later. So what we began to learn at 350 is that there was a pretty significant reason why protest didn't lead to policy change, and it was the fossil fuel industry whispering in the ear of governments, or sometimes being the government. And it was the lobbying power of the likes of Exxon, the American Petroleum Institute, Arch Coal, and state-owned oil and gas companies that were dictating national policy, as we're increasingly seeing in this country. And moreover, these groups were funding organizations who spread misinformation, clouding the issue and therefore delaying policy action. So we realized that until we confronted that, we'd see little progress, and we could organize all the days of action we wanted, but if we couldn't make the work more pointed, we would not see impact. So we helped organize sit-ins at the White House protesting a tar sands pipeline, the Keystone XL. Many people were arrested, including me, probably including some people in this room. Tar sands contribute the most of all fossil fuels to climate change. And we were still small enough that our enemies didn't seem to care much about this. But then threats started to come, and I'll tell you about those in a second. We are still nowhere near as threatened as groups who are sitting on the front lines of this problem, particularly indigenous peoples, whose lands are often taken away violently. But we are in this interesting middle space of both an NGO and a nonprofit organization with a broad reach, but very connected into social movements. So some of these threats are starting to emerge. So what I'd like to turn to now is this aspect of oppressive regimes and how they relate to climate action. And I want to start by linking climate change to energy and energy policy to regimes and political power. In the United States, we recently went from being a net energy importer to a net energy exporter because we have abundant fossil fuel reserves in this country, some of which weren't economically viable to produce until quite recently. And for developed countries, we have been the historical laggard on reducing our emissions. Obama made some significant changes in this direction and engaged quite differently with the international community leading up to 2015's Paris Agreement. But when we think about how long scientists have warned Congress, from James Hansen's own testimony in 1988, and from efforts like Princeton's own Michael Oppenheimer, 2015 was quite a long ways to wait for that action. Here's what the climate crisis looks like right now. And I won't give an exhaustive list because I know you all could probably do that even better. But just to cite a few things. Sea ice loss is at historically low levels, and what this means is it can contribute to sea level rise and the inundation of low-lying coastal areas, which could mean dislocation of billions of people around the world. Right now, in Chicago, which is famous for its winters, it's recorded no snowfall in January and February for the first time in recorded history. And right here where we are, it's 60 degrees today, and it's supposed to snow tomorrow. And these types of events, obviously, are weather and not climate change, but these kinds of patterns are how we know something is not working the way it's supposed to do. If we look at the example of the oceans, which I think is a good way of imagining how this issue operates at a massive scale. So as we burn more fossil fuels and put more carbon dioxide into the atmosphere, it makes the ocean more acidic. That means that shellfish can't grow their shells as effectively, which means that fish can't eat the shellfish that they rely on, which means that anyone who makes their livelihood fishing, which is a lot of the world, no longer has a livelihood, and in some cases, leads to mass hunger. And so you see how something that begins in the ocean actually affects many, many people all around the world. It's, of course, a problem affecting the most vulnerable people already, and will affect all of us. But what determines how you deal with it often depends on your race, your class, your age, and your gender. Our best hope, and it's a truly beautiful hope that is worth investing our energy into, is this: that the age of fossil fuels may already be over. Many sources cite the age of peak coal might already be here, that the rapidly declining cost of a solar panel is only going to accelerate, that the challenge of storage of energy is being resolved through state-of-the-art battery technology, that oil and the internal combustion engine could become obsolete with improved electric vehicles. The clean energy sector is good news for many reasons, and it's a growing part of the economy, indeed one of the fastest growing sectors. it also has the potential to democratize. Every place is windy and sunny sometimes, as compared to with fossil fuels, which simply empower those few that happen to find themselves sitting on top of the fossil fuels. But it's not the only part of the story. There is another even bigger way to think of the green economy, and Naomi Klein, as well as the climate justice movement, have been brilliant on this point. Jobs in education, in healthcare, in childcare and domestic work, in creating public transportation systems, sustainable food systems, and localized agriculture, these are all job-creating opportunities in a green economy. And it's a good thing because scientists tell us we must leave 75% of all known fossil fuel reserves underground in order to stay below 2 degrees Celsius of warming. Yet the fossil fuel industry has more than 5 times this on their balance sheets. We refer to this as the climate math. So this is how we have come to understand that this industry is truly rogue. It's the combination of what we know about climate change and its impacts, and what an industry that knows all about this is planning to do to make more money off of this problem. And that's where we get into the dangerous relationships with governments. But if we think about this industry as rogue, ask anyone interfacing with them on the ground, and they knew this a long time ago. Ask the family of Ken Saro-Wiwa, who was murdered for his anti-oil activism confronting Shell. Ask Prasita Chai Nunuan and her two of her comrades, Thai activists who were detained February 18th in a notorious Thai prison for protesting a coal-fired power plant. Ask Bill McKibben, my friend and co-founder of 350.org, who last year was frequently followed around by video trackers who were funded by the oil industry to follow his every move. They even followed his daughter once. These tactics look different everywhere, but the impact of intimidation and creating a chilling effect can be quite similar. These are particularly pernicious because often these attacks result in the silencing of activists who are already taking enormous risks, often to their own livelihoods, in order to be heard. Here is a map put together by the excellent human rights group Civicus, which is a real-time monitor of hotspots for oppressive governments. And the US was not always this color, by the way. We all know why. But this map also largely maps onto places where there are a lot of known fossil fuel resources that are being extracted as we speak. So at 350.org, we focus mostly on the causes that have to do with the fossil fuel sector. And along with mining interests, these play a disproportionate role on some of these human rights attacks. And what this looks like is intimidation of activists who attempt to stop coal plants from being built in their communities, to fracking wells, to oil drilling and refining. The term environmental defenders is an increasingly common term used in human rights circles because so many of the people being affected are protecting land and water. Often these are indigenous peoples, and many of you probably saw the violence that was inflicted at the Standing Rock camp in the Dakotas, as well as the FBI monitoring many of those activists. And the people perpetuating this aren't dumb. They know their product is dangerous, both in terms of local impacts as well as the impacts on the climate. And they know that in most places, most people would prefer an alternative to this. And in some ways, the violence is a last resort to keep this industry viable. I wasn't even aware of how acute the problem was until I attended a conference in Berlin on the issue of shrinking civic space, a term many find to be too mild to describe harassment and even death, but also loss of legal status and therefore ability for NGOs to do their work. This was a conference where activists from dozens of countries from Kenya, Indonesia, Egypt, Cameroon were sharing stories about what they'd experienced that I'll never forget, and countless examples of new laws that were being passed to make their day-to-day activities almost impossible. So, I have to figure out my pages. Sorry. I knew this was going to happen. Give me 1 second. So just turning to some of the experiences that we've actually faced at 350.org and what we're doing to respond, it started with actually our work in India, where we were focused on trying to stop the expansion of coal, which is a major source of pollution in India, including air pollution. And along with Greenpeace, Avaaz, and the Sierra Club, all of a sudden, the bank accounts of our staff members were being monitored and then shut down. So they weren't able to pay for anything when we weren't able to pay them to do their work. And for Greenpeace, it actually meant that their office almost closed down entirely. And it was unique to groups that were fighting the coal industry. And so now we're working in Bangladesh, which also is building a lot of coal plants, but is a little safer in terms of civil society, and doing this while we try to get back on our feet in India. In Brazil, our team has their phones tapped, and I just heard last week that they also think that they are being followed around. And our campaign in Brazil is about stopping fracking in the Amazon, which, let that sink in for a second, that people are fracking in the Amazon. And we've been able to get 200 towns in Brazil to ban fracking. So it's starting to work, and there is some real momentum, but there is now a bit of a backlash. So we're trying to publish an article about our funding sources and our independence, and trying to make the case that we're not being funded to try to disrupt the Brazilian government, that our interest in this is actually climate change and coal. And in Turkey, where there's many, many different crackdowns on civil society, in the wake of some of the bombings that have happened, the Prime Minister, Erdogan, has passed some new laws somewhat quietly that make it harder to build any kind of, or make it easier, excuse me, to build new fossil fuel infrastructure projects. And infrastructure of any kind, but in Turkey there are about 60 to 80, depending on who you ask, new coal-fired power plants that are being proposed. But again, in Turkey, just in the last few weeks, the coalition and the movement has shut down 4 of these coal plants. So even under these conditions, activists are able to mount really impressive resistance and fights. And it was actually our Turkish team, which is really a team of one person, who, after the election, wrote all of us an email and said, "It's going to be okay. I know you're all losing hope right now, but let us remind you what we are facing in Turkey and that what we have still been able to do." So looking at this problem as a whole, beyond even fossil fuels, it wouldn't be fair to have a topic like this without talking about Honduras and Berta Cáceres, who many of you are probably familiar with. And she was fighting damming in Honduras and was assassinated almost a year ago exactly. And she had won the Goldman Environmental Prize, which is a very significant international award. And her case really was a wake-up call for people that even if you're well-known, it does not mean that you're necessarily protected in that way. And so, and there's increasingly some evidence that some aspects of the government may have known about this. I'm not gonna say that I know for sure, but it's the collaboration between industry interests and government that makes this problem of oppressive regimes so important and therefore stands in the way of climate policy action happening. But to the point of this whole conversation, climate action under oppressive regimes means finding more creative ways of doing the work you were doing before, of also needing to be more careful about how you communicate, but recognizing that often, as with the case of our Turkish colleagues and our Indian colleagues, they are finding new and different ways of working. The idea now for a lot of the groups in India is they're focusing on air pollution, which Delhi is quickly becoming the world's most polluted city, and you can do a lot to focus on coal by talking about air pollution that is slightly less threatening but still gets the same results. So it's often a matter of finding a different way in. Climate action in these conditions means having a real unshakable faith in the movement that you're part of, and the idea that others are paying attention to what you're doing and that you're not isolated and that your story will be shared and remembered. And this is why we organized a series of actions called Break Free in May of last year. Along with 10 other organizations, there were events in 13 countries, all focused on major fossil fuel projects in those places: Nigeria, Turkey, Brazil, South Africa, the US, Bangladesh. We did it to show that the movement that's trying to stop expansion of fossil fuels is united and is actually a global force. And we did it because people felt that it was easy to have their struggle in Indonesia to be pretending like it was just the Indonesians. And they wanted to be able to say, no, actually, we're part of something much bigger. We're not here fighting this on our own. And so more and more of these kinds of global solidarity efforts are being mounted. Nevertheless, we persist, right? And our allies in the environmental movement are no stranger to this either, particularly Greenpeace, Rainforest Action Network, the Sierra Club. They know the lengths that some companies will go to. But the shared risk of shrinking democratic space also has provided new opportunities for alliances with human rights organizations and activists and new ways of understanding how climate change relates to questions of human rights, governance, and democracy. So I think our best defense of all is to not limit our own sense of possibility. As we remind ourselves often, these attacks are happening because of effectiveness. The fossil fuel divestment campaign, which seeks to encourage investors to move their money out of the top 200 oil, coal, and gas companies, this has helped spread an argument about carbon risk that is now mainstream economic thinking. This is not just coming from activists anymore. Mark Carney of the Bank of England, Michael Bloomberg, they're now the main proponents of this argument. And this is affecting what investors are doing and the ability for them to finance projects. So it is having an impact, and that's why we think this backlash is taking place. And all of these movements' gains get a lot of attention. For us, we had a particular experience with Exxon, which I will share, which is a perfect segue to talking about Donald Trump. I'll get there in a second. But with Exxon, we started thinking about, well, there was a fantastic piece of investigative journalism in the Los Angeles Times about how long ago Exxon's own scientists were studying climate change, and then what, how much time elapsed before they started to fund a climate denial campaign. Are people sort of familiar with this story? Yeah, more or less. So basically, Exxon knew about climate change before most people and started to protect the company because they saw it was an existential threat. But rather than change their behavior, they instead, you know, seeded this idea that science on climate change was still somewhat in doubt. And so we started to publicize this Los Angeles Times article because we thought it was really important people know about this. And a number of attorneys general, including New York and Massachusetts, launched an investigation into what Exxon knew and how long they'd known about it. And shortly thereafter, we received a subpoena from Lamar Smith, representative from Texas, claiming that our campaign was a violation of Exxon's right to free speech, their right to deny climate change. And so that was a little insight into how our government is connected to Exxon. And then later we got a subpoena directly from Exxon, which was more scary because they are more powerful than this congressional committee. So we'll see what happens with this, but it did mean that the election of Donald Trump didn't come totally as a surprise, and nor did the nomination of Rex Tillerson to Secretary of State. But so what? Some of what we're paying most attention to is, first and foremost, having a former oil industry CEO running the State Department, and therefore the levels of corruption that we could expect. Paying attention, as you were putting it in the introduction, to Scott Pruitt and his plans around the EPA. Certainly to the effort to keep fossil fuels in the ground, which was actually gaining some momentum for a while, and I think still can. But Trump wants to have $1 trillion worth of infrastructure, and I think a lot of his definition includes oil pipelines. Our definition includes public transportation. And of course, Paris, and the importance of having a global climate agreement. Even though it needs a lot of improvement, having that in place is incredibly important for acting at the scale that we need to. But here is what we're doing about it, and here is where I'm going to wrap up. First, being really clear-eyed about the fact that this is a real threat. And part of why I went into this topic, which is really grim, is that I think we have to be very clear about what we're up against if we're going to come up with strategies to confront it. So we call ourselves 350.org after a scientific target. We're all about being honest about the state of the problem. So with Trump, not pretend, not thinking maybe it won't be so bad, but thinking, let's imagine it's going to be, is working in a cross-movement framework and recognizing that a lot of our allies and other movements are feeling this much more painfully before we are going to feel it, particularly hate crimes that are happening all over the country, the ban, all of the different ways that people are already being impacted and being afraid for their livelihoods and their lives, and working in a cross-movement manner to respond and to build a movement that's much more resilient for the future. And one of the things that a lot of people are thinking about is, what are some of the areas within the progressive movement where we don't agree? I'm sure we can all think of about 10 things. And in this moment where there is so much to be concerned about, can we actually start to build the bridges we need to on the things that we're not aligned about within ourselves, so that when we gain power again, hopefully soon, we're able to move really quickly in the direction we needed to all along. So for us, a lot of that is the conflict we have often with the labor movement and this tension between, can we create jobs while stopping pipelines? Which we believe that we can, and that's why I said all those things about clean energy and jobs in the green economy. So really trying to make headway in this area during this time. Another big strategy is relocalization, and a lot of movements are thinking about this as well. And I think for climate, there's already a great track record of work that's happened at the local and state level, from what California, my home state, has been able to do on clean energy, to the fracking bans that have been put in place, to some of the investment policies in clean energy that are happening nationwide. And also at the city level, where mayors can actually have a lot of influence, public utility commissions throughout the country that can make decisions about what kind of energy use we're putting onto the grid. So really ramping up those efforts. And I think in the electoral sphere, this is, I think, incredibly important. I think the 2018 election will be here before we know it, and it's a chance to really launch a big counter push, and a lot of people are working on this. Two more. One is global, and really thinking about who are the other leaders globally who are still completely on board with climate action, and how can their voices be louder. And lastly, getting our story back and getting back in our own narrative. And I think one of the things that's most challenging with Trump is this chaotic communication style where it constantly throws everyone off balance. So just when you think you know what the fight is, the terrain of the battle changes. And no wonder we're having a hard time getting anything done. But I think for us, the strategy is around remembering this story about clean energy jobs and solutions to climate change is as good a story now as it was on November 7th. And it's actually a great way of exposing phony economic populism with something that is truly economically populist. So the People's Climate March in DC, this is the entire message. It's a march for jobs, justice, and climate, and really trying to be positive and be solutions oriented and therefore be hopeful, and get out of this fearful framework that I think Trump so desperately wants us to stay stuck in. So that's an opportunity to remember that we can be positive and hopeful while being completely real in the face of what the threats are. So I really hope you all can join. And I want to end by acknowledging that, you know, in the title of this talk, you can substitute the word hope for climate action. And so to that end, I want to quote from I think the prophetess of hope, Rebecca Solnit, who, if folks aren't familiar with her work, I really recommend it. So this is a quote from her book, Hope in the Dark. Social, cultural, or political change does not work in predictable ways or on predictable schedules. The month before the Berlin Wall fell, almost no one anticipated that the Soviet bloc was going to disintegrate all of a sudden, thanks to many factors, including the tremendous power of civil society, nonviolent direct action, and hopeful organizing going back to the 1970s. That, any more than anyone, even the participants, foresaw the impact that the Arab Spring or Occupy Wall Street or a host of other great uprisings would have. We don't know what is going to happen or how or when, and that very uncertainty is the space of hope. Those who doubt that these moments emerge should note how terrified the authorities and elites are when they erupt. That fear signifies their recognition that popular power is real enough to overturn regimes and rewrite the social contract, and it often has. Sometimes your enemies know what your friends can't believe. Those who dismiss these moments because of their imperfections, limitations, or incompleteness need to look harder at what joy and hope shine out of them and what real changes have emerged because of them, even if not always in the most obvious or recognizable ways. Thank you. Yes.
It's important to mention them because they're a minor.
Absolutely. They did a lot of the hardcore work of it, but I feel like more people know the LA Times.
Fair enough.
Good
okay.
point. Good point.
So my question is, one of the recent goals of 350 has been to increase renewable R&D. I was wondering to what extent you think Mission Innovation has made this something that's being concretized, whether you think it's insufficient or whether 350 is trying to support that mission, or you think they're separate.
On innovation in particular, I mean, this is really not my area of expertise, but I do think that bigger picture on the question of who's the most convincing argument maker for clean energy, it's not me. It's probably the solar and wind industry, because they're actually creating jobs and doing this R&D work themselves. So we don't get too much in the policy details, but we often find that the best way to stop a coal plant project, and there are hundreds being proposed all around the world, is actually the positive argument that it's not even needed, that there's plenty of solar or wind available in that same place, so you don't even need to build it in the first place. So as long as there is enough real evidence that that is true, that's what we need to be able to do our work. Yeah. Thank you. Go ahead.
Yeah, I have a question about actually on your website. You mentioned stop all new fossil fuel projects.
Right.
What is your opinion, or maybe 350's opinion, on carbon capture and storage and engaging with fossil fuel companies?
Yeah, so thus far, we have felt that carbon capture and storage is a way of delaying the inevitable, which is to actually transition off of fossil fuels. And so I think as long as it's being used as an excuse to not do that, we think it's problematic. But there is also a new field of study that's emerging about if we are serious about limiting warming to 2 degrees or even 1.5 degrees, which is really much safer for most people, that it's going to be very difficult technologically to do that without carbon capture and storage. So people are trying to look at this question anew in the light of that and see, is there anything in here that we think is justifiable? And some people whom we really trust are trying to figure this out. So trying to keep an open mind while being very clear that often the argument is coming from a place of, it's often research funded by the fossil fuel industry to say, please don't make us stop making money from this. So that's why we've been in that framework for a long time. Yeah. Red shirt in the back. Yeah, not surprisingly, we get this question often. And I'll tell a story that I told a few of you earlier as well after this. But I think a few things. One, there are definitely efforts to have people ride trains and caravan on trains, just like there were for New York, and just like for the Women's March. So using all the public transportation options available to us, which in this country are, as we know, woefully inadequate. But definitely that's a big aspect. And there have been efforts in the past to have people I remember this in Copenhagen, to actually like caravan on boat and bicycle all the way to Copenhagen. So for people who want to do that, there's often like very good examples. Where I feel like we have to be careful with this is that if the bar of our ability to act is how like non-hypocritical we are, we will never succeed on this issue in particular, because we're all contributing to it. And so I don't hide the fact that I'm a contributor. I fly more than I should. And I think we need to both be limiting our individual contribution, but recognizing that if that's what's stopping people from being active in this movement because they feel like they have to be like certifiably environmentalist, we're not going to build a big enough movement. I have a lot of friends who will like we'll be having a conversation and they'll be holding a plastic bag and they'll feel like they'll have to explain to me why they have the plastic bag. I'm like, I don't care that you have a plastic bag. It's okay with me. But this happened to Bill McKibben. There was somebody who took a picture of him shopping for Thanksgiving with plastic bags because he told me it was the one day he forgot his tote bags in his Prius, right? And so they put this photo on Twitter as a joke. And like a bunch of right-wing bloggers blasted it everywhere just to say, Bill McKibben is a hypocrite. Don't pay attention to anything he says. So we're constantly being subjected to this, like they're trying to get us and catch us in the act so as to discredit our work. So as long as we're clear that is out there, and at the same time we're trying to be in line with our values, I'm all for all the alternative methods. But we're such easy targets in that way. So recognizing that that's probably not going to go away. Okay, you sir.
I've got two questions for you, one fairly specific and the other a lot more general. As I recall, Brazil had put on a big push to get energy independent as a country, largely by adopting biomass projects,
right,
burning corn instead,
right,
of oil, which,
right,
doesn't help the carbon situation much. So,
right,
how are you dealing with
that? Yeah, so interestingly, before we worked on fracking, we were working on this. Because in Brazil, like the agricultural interests are as politically powerful as the fossil fuel interests are here. Not that our agricultural interests are not powerful. They're very powerful. So we were doing some work on that and trying to see if we could make headway. But it was not picking up any steam, unfortunately. And so it's still work that we support, but our particular approach, for whatever reason, was not getting people interested into the campaign, but in part probably because we mostly work on fossil fuels. So when we started to work on fracking, it was like a little bit more clear. So I do know I know Greenpeace works a lot on this in Brazil. So their work is worth checking out. And I know there's a lot of local groups and a lot of indigenous groups in Brazil that also are, you know, protecting their own forests from land use and industrial agriculture problems.
Okay, the more general question is, how do you, there's many problems and limited resources and energy. So how do you track what works and to find the leverage points that make the effort get the biggest bang?
Yeah, it's a really good question. And we're often asking ourselves the same thing. And so because a lot of our work is about this kind of elusive concept of movement building and shifting the narrative, it can be particularly difficult to track. But we pay a lot of attention to how climate change is being talked about in the press and in lots of different corners of the press. But we do track the mainstream conversation about the issue. And so for example, the fact that I think it's increasingly being talked about as an economic issue, an issue affecting people, we see as big progress, and that we've helped contribute to that because we've tried to shift the conversation in that way. We also look a lot at a number of people involved and the growth of new groups, the growth of new activists joining our email list, taking action. We also track not as carefully, but we track partnerships and what new movements are we starting to be in relationship with. So the human rights movement, as I mentioned, is sort of a newer partner, but That's our way of understanding, again, are we building a bigger movement? Is climate change being increasingly understood as a multifaceted problem? So that's often been important to us as well. So there's lots of different things, and we don't really have a methodology, and our program team really wants us to have one. So we're working on something so that we could hopefully provide that in all of our different places where we're working. So it can be more of a decentralized system that people are using. Thank you. In the back? Yeah?
Actually, wanted to pick up on the biomass question. Full disclosure, I'm from Montana. I believe that biomass should be a wedge in our renewables. So I'm curious how much of conversation there is in the circles that you're talking about as biomass as a viable element in a solution, or is it very much off the table because of
So two things, and I should have said this earlier, but because our primary work is advocacy and mobilization, we don't do a lot of research and policy work, so we don't take positions on a whole lot of things, in part because a lot of other groups do the research and have a better understanding, mostly because, again, our work is the movement work, and so we want to build the widest tent possible. And the more we constrain ourselves into we think X and you can't talk to us if you think Y, the less we can do that. So this gets us into trouble all the time because people see inconsistencies and can't make sense of where we stand, and that's legitimate. So I'm happy to debate that too. But so on biomass particularly, like we don't have a position. In the Brazilian context, it was very clear cut. No pun intended, because of the deforestation problem linked to agriculture and biomass. But just speaking of Middlebury and the carbon neutrality commitment we made, it's totally based on biomass. And over the years, people have become very frustrated that that's how that commitment was met. So I don't know the issue well enough to like have a strong personal opinion on it. But I do think that just like with CCS, a lot of these things are more complicated than they first appear. And so being able to have a nuanced debate that doesn't immediately divide people into camps where they can't work together on anything is where I would like us to get to as a movement. Yeah. Go ahead.
Yeah. So I went back to the kind of the narrative about more some of the things you work on. And one of the things I've always thought challenging about some of these issues is like the tension between feeling completely defeated, there's no hope, and then to the point of like something that feels actionable and real. I mean, I think the Great Barrier Reef story was terrible, for example. The backlash on the social media has been just so deafening in my right-wing space. But so how do you balance that? I mean, like in your experience, and I don't, it may be hard to summarize in something 50, but how do you balance like this is something real, this is something you can do, this is something we can solve, versus like no, this is a perfect collective failure problem, and there's no way this is going to work. I mean, like, how do you balance that to get people engaged and involved and willing to make change?
Yeah, I mean, I would ask a question of the audience about, you know, in terms of this, like, how, on a scale of, like, a lot of despair to not a lot of despair after hearing this, like, where are you guys? You know, on the, like, more despair than I came in with show of hands? Okay, like, about the same show of hands? Okay, and like less show of hands? All right, great. So it really depends. I think it really depends. I mean, and it sometimes for me, honestly, it depends on the kind of day I've had. Like if I'm really, really worried, like that is gonna come across. Like sometimes there's a particularly terrible thing that happens and we need to talk about it, you know? And so to your question about influencing audiences,
yeah,
I would say
strategy,
it depends. But
yeah.
I think on the whole, we try to be, we don't have a term for this, but optimistic and kind of youthful, like sort of we see the positive future in our kind of attitude, but the substance of what we talk about is often very clearly depressing. So it's like telling the truth with a smile on our face, you know? And so that's, I think that's where we try to position ourselves. But this is not Bill McKibben's approach. I mean, but he now laughs about it. He calls himself a professional bummer outer because his talks are like 80%, this is the science and you've got to know this because it's serious. And so this is, I think, a really healthy debate in the movement about what is the right balance between telling people, because the true story about clean energy is a true story, and it happens to be very positive. So that you're not being Pollyanna-ish if you explain all the great trends in solar. But I think if you only say that and you don't talk about the other side of the equation, that's a little bit disingenuous, but I think that's a matter of expertise and choice. So I think different, as I said at the beginning, we all respond to this stuff somewhat differently. So, yeah.
So there are a lot of sectors can you hear me okay?
Yeah, yeah.
So there are a lot of sectors that have a nexus with climate change. So there's health and climate change, energy security and climate change, jobs and climate change. And obviously, your messaging is going to depend on what audience you're speaking to. But I'm kind of curious that on balance, you know, if you were just sort of talking to your average climate skeptic, what is the tack that's most effective?
Okay, so full disclosure, a lot of my extended family are climate skeptics. And I don't talk to them about this. And I don't, because I don't believe I'm going to change their minds, which is really hard because I am their family member. So just as an anecdote, they live in Michigan. So I was like, okay, got to do my political duty to try to convince my climate denier family not to vote for Donald Trump. So I wrote this long note that was like, all the things you're told you're supposed to do when talking to deniers. Be honest, tell your personal story, don't make it about the facts, make it about your own experience. And I got like no traction. maybe one of my aunts moved. I can't quite tell. She won't tell me who she voted for, but so I assume she voted for Donald Trump. But all kidding aside, I do think that there is probably a portion of the climate deniers who are not going to change their mind. And we're just going to frustrate ourselves, and our energy is better spent elsewhere. There are probably a set of people who might change their minds. And I think they're not trying to compete on a fact basis is definitely important. And trying to remember that there is some of the hesitation is about elitism. Some of the hesitation is thinking that people who believe in this issue don't care about people who live in rural areas, who work in the coal industry, for example. And so I think there's a level of openness, vulnerability, empathy, and that's, again, in a one-on-one setting. The best thing that's happening in this arena, I think, is this wonderful climate scientist whose name is Catherine Hayhoe, who's in Texas, and who is an evangelical Christian, fully, card-carrying member, not that that's how it works, and a climate scientist. And so she is going around Texas talking, like preaching the gospel of climate science. And she's finding a lot of people are willing to listen to what she has to say because they don't immediately assume she's judging them, which is, I think, how people feel sometimes. So she, I think, is a wonderful model. And I know there's some other people trying to organize, you know, within the Republican Party who see that being seen as the party that's anti-science is not helpful long-term for the party. So, long story short, I don't think I am a good messenger for this, even with my own family. But thankfully, I think there are people who are better messengers. Yeah. Oh, I said you'd be next. Go ahead. And then you. Yeah.
It's part and parcel of the same question, but more from the psychology perspective. Putting aside the deniers, I think there was a recent around the election or after polls that showed climate and the environment, in fact, pretty close to the bottom of what anybody cares about.
Right.
And when I say anybody, I don't mean the people in Princeton University and the Princeton universities of this country and the world, but and you're about activism. That's the purpose of your organization. So what is there to do with the psychology? Because this is something they're not dealing with at the moment. You know, they're dealing maybe with not having a job or this or that. But what is there for to get people to even think this is out of all of the issues an important thing to pay attention to when they're not, the flood isn't coming at this moment.
Yeah. So one of the people who is at Princeton who was sitting two people over from you is actually working, she left, but she's working on this issue exactly, on behavioral psychology and kind of breaking down exactly this question and doing really interesting research. So her name is Elka Weber. Yeah, so just so you know, you have a great resource for this right here in your community. I think in terms of breaking this down, we just basically test by doing. So the messages that we send out, some of them catch on and some of them don't. And so that's kind of our inexact way of telling what's reaching people. To get ourselves out of our own comfort zone, we need to figure out how to reach people who are maybe concerned about the issue but who are not activists, which is who I think we originally reached. But over the years, I think we've gotten a little too narrow in speaking to one community. And so I think one of the things that's been really notable to me is the really widespread opposition to destroying the EPA. Turns out the EPA is very popular, and not just among environmentalists. And so there's, I think, a lot of people out there who do see this and want to do something about it. But I blame our movement and not the people. Like, I think we're doing something wrong if we're not finding a way to get people in. So we and a lot of environmental groups are asking this question. And a lot of it has to do, too, with maybe your entry point isn't environmentalism. It's religion, and this is a moral issue. Or it's the arts and helping to visualize, like, what is the alternative world we're trying to create. So not trying to get people into our silo, but get them where they are and help everybody see how climate links across a whole host of different issues. And just on the point you said about where climate and environment ranks on a list, there was a great piece about this. I forget where it was, but this was also true up to the lead up to the first Earth Day. Like, it, even then, it like never ranks that highly, but when you look at, I'm gonna get the statistics wrong, but there is something about how a number of people still rank it as important. They just will never rank it as the most important. So I think people take the conclusion that, oh, people don't care. And I don't think it's that people don't care. They just care about other more immediate issues first. So deportations. If that's facing your family, that's number one on your list. I wouldn't expect people to put climate change above that. But does that mean they don't care? Usually not. So I think it's this question of recognizing not everyone is going to become really obsessed with this issue, and that's okay, but we can build an expansive enough movement that people who want to do something can still feel part of it.
We have a few minutes left. I'd like to invite the students in particular to ask questions.
Okay, sorry, I can't see very well.
Okay, so I'm just going to actually ask a question that relates more to what you were saying this morning when you visited our class, but you talked about how important local movements are, especially now that, you know, we have some obstacles in the way.
Right.
So, and you also talked about how you have different sort of divisions of your organization in the world, and they're marketed differently. So I was wondering, what's your opinion on international cooperation between local communities?
Mm.
I don't know if this really happens here, but in Europe, we have, like, partner towns, where, like, a Czech town would have, like, even a small town would have a partnering town in, like, France, for example. And the town, the mayors and stuff would work together on projects. So I was wondering what you think about, is that a way to address this, where, like, would American local communities be open, or would it be feasible to cooperate with, for example, matters such as public transportation
I love that idea. And fortunately, there are some examples of this. So, and I'd say particularly with cities. So there's this group, I think I mentioned, called C40, which connects mayors mostly of larger cities, and they share exactly this. How did you implement said policy on purchasing that's more sustainable? And so really serving as resources for each other. But on the activist level, in some ways we try to do this. So we have a network of local groups, and they are active all over the world, but we occasionally will do workshops where one of them will present on something that they've done. And then, so something around, how do you get more members to come to your meetings, which every organizer is always trying to figure out. And so they, you know, 350 Minnesota would host that webinar and then open it up to all the other 350 groups anywhere to learn about what they did. And in many ways, we try to get ourselves out of the way and just talking to each other. So that's some of it. And we do have this, I'm a big fan of the Sister Cities projects. I don't know if you guys are familiar with this, but my hometown growing up had like six sister cities in really cool places like Italy and France. And so, but it's mostly, they're mostly cultural exchanges. They're not necessarily policy implementation exchanges. But I do think that venue could be a really powerful one for some of this kind of work. So in essence, yes, I agree with you, and there's some efforts, but they're not, they could definitely use more momentum. And just on that point, one thing I forgot to say is that one of the places where there's been a lot of this local sharing is the fossil fuel divestment campaign. And I know Princeton has a divestment campaign, and I believe, is Jonathan here? There's Jonathan. So if you want to learn more about what Princeton is doing specifically on this, you should talk to Jonathan after this. And you're welcome to say a couple things now, like if you're having a meeting upcoming or something.
We're doing right now.
Okay. Okay, well, he's your man. But divestment has been a really good example of this. So, and this has been a truly global level of resource sharing. So, you know, how did you get your town council to approve divestment? What's the best power? What PowerPoint did you use? What's the most convincing statistic for a board of trustees? All of these kinds of things have been really valuable. One more student question.
I'm from Washington. As I'm sure you're familiar, they recently had a carbon tax that was voted down. And I think a lot of the politics there were between two camps, one that wanted a more like a sort of revenue neutral carbon tax that thought it could get Republicans and sort of everyone on board with, and the other that saw climate change was really specifically an environmental justice issue, and that like that was the right frame to look at it. And you were talking about like this being a time to build bridges between progressive issues, and I would be curious if you think there's any resolution to that issue, and also if you have any personal opinions on which approach makes more sense.
Yeah, this gentleman in the hat and I were talking about this yesterday. So yeah, this was a really very contentious fight in the state of Washington about carbon pricing. And our conclusion was that we haven't really unpacked it actually as a movement because this is not the last time this is going to happen. And I think because of the massive surprise of Trump after the election, a lot of local and state ballot initiatives like didn't get as much attention after the fact. So I think in this particular case, it's those two camps are not going to go away. This tension about how, which policy can we get done the quickest and which policy is going to be the most fair, particularly around inequality around race and gender and class. Like, we're gonna keep having that argument and we should be able to design a policy that can do both things. And there are good examples of carbon pricing. I don't know the best examples, like I don't know who the gold standard is, but I think we're going to need that. And so I think the short answer is, I hope that that conversation is happening in Washington and I hope they can share it with the rest of us because I think it's important learning. And I also think that, you know, this is something that we can learn from the right. They have ALEC, American Legislative Exchange, probably missing a word there. Which is all about how to help states pass the right kind of policy really quickly. So they, if it works in one place, they get a ton of other state legislatures to pass it. So it would be so cool if we could do this with carbon pricing, if we could establish a gold standard and then have a bunch of people work on it. So we could do something like that. And we do have an equivalent on the progressive side. It's called the State Innovation Exchange. And there's other ones too, but that's one of the best ones. So we need that to happen. But otherwise, Washington is really leading the way.
Do you have time for one more question?
I'm not a student, but I just want to ask a question.
Is that possible? I think that, the students are without a question, so the floor is yours.
Do you have any type of a PAC to support these politicians? Because it seems to me that you have very formidable adversaries who have a vast amount of revenue, which can open doors and influence opinion makers. Do you compete with them in that way, or do you just preach your message?
Yeah. We don't have a PAC. We have a 501c4, which does enable us to take positions on legislation and endorse candidates. It's very small, though. There are climate PACs. Tom Steyer, who's a hedge fund billionaire, created a massive one recently called Next Gen Climate, League of Conservation Voters. We do have examples, but they're not nearly robust enough to compete with the opposition. It's a huge need, and I think, you know, my kind of casual reference to 2018, a lot of it is about this. It's not just the Republicans either. There are plenty of Democrats who are kind of out to lunch on this issue, we need better Democrats too on this front. It is a big need. I guess what I would say is when it comes to getting people to be really great at knocking on doors and contacting voters, and you guys have probably volunteered for political campaigns, so you know that that's kind of an art unto itself. There are a lot of groups that are really great at that, and so we've hesitated to create our own kind of duplicate 350 version of that, and rather try to encourage our members to join something existing. So we're part of trying to create like a kind of cross-movement version of that for 2018. So stay tuned. That could launch anytime, hopefully.
Okay, well, thank you so much.
Thank you. And I'm serious about the 6 buses. I'll be keeping